Right, our next speaker is Stephen Daniels from Dublin City University, and he's going to speak about pyrometer estimation and pulse plasma discharges.
Or something like that.
Or something like that.
Thanks, Timo. So while we're getting set up, I just want to thank the organizers for being here, and I congratulate you on, I think, really an excellent workshop. Really great talks until now. And when I say sort of, I'm going to talk about work we do in DCU. And we don't have any serious pulse plasma work in actual fact ongoing. Albeit we use pulse plasmas for PVD of various coatings and that. But I'm going to try and mention the word pulse at a few points throughout my talk for the arrangement. So. Okay, you've abandoned me here. How do I? Perfect. Okay, so thanks. Okay, so I'll try within 45 minutes do the talk. I know it's the last talk. So I'm going to, given the fact, 40-minute talk, given the fact that you're in Dublin, I'm going to introduce DCU's centre, our National Centre for Plasma Science and Technology. I'm going to give some motivation for my talk, and I got a number of things I'm going to talk about. I'm going to talk about process variation, control, and parameter estimation. I have a large group in the university, and as a consequence, I don't know work. So the work that I present is really the work of the students and so on. And Samir, Yang, Evgeny, and others have some posters, I think, tomorrow. Any details, better ask them than me, in truth. So our National Center for Plasma Science and Technology was formed formally in 1999 with a large block grant from the government. And in truth, plasma work in DCU started with Mike Hopkins and a few others well before that time. They were the instigator for plasma research in Ireland, pretty much. But we've got about, sorry, principal is spelled wrong, excuse me, 18 faculty members and about 80 total membership, including students and so on. And investment to date is of that order of magnitude by Irish standard. That's a lot of money. And our outputs since in the last 10, 12 years or so, you know, a lot of papers, quite a lot of PhD students that have ended up in industry. We're quite entrepreneurial, so we've had at least 7 startups over the last number of years that are still successful trading. And Mike Hopkins, if he's still here. No, he is down the back. He's been responsible for at least 2 of them, if not more. And we pride ourselves in saying we've had significant technology transfer into manufacturing in Ireland. And we're kind of unique in Ireland in the fact we've got a massive semiconductor manufacturing plant that you could puck up all to from our university, which is fantastic for us particularly. But it enables us to interact in a very positive way with industrial partners. And there's also a large medical device industry in Ireland as well, for example. And it gives us plenty of opportunity to work with industry. And within the center, there's a lot of, there's quite a few different research, not so much programs as themes. Some of these, like in everywhere, some are more active than others, but manufacturing is really where I sit, medical devices to a lesser extent. We've got some work on sustainable energy, but it's really materials for sustainable energy, photovoltaics and LEDs and so on. We have a nuclear fusion program. We work mostly on neutral beam injection modeling, that's Miles Turner. Nanoscience, photonics, materials, a lot of people working on lasers. We've got our mathematicians, and we do a little bit of work as well on sources. And I suppose we do a lot of work in diagnostics and measurement. I'm going to be talking a little bit about some of that today. And we do have our astrophysics, which are fantastic for outreach and things like that. Don't like me saying that, of course. And within the center, we've strong, primarily led by Miles Turner. We have a good, strong fundamentals group, and Miles, well known for his PIC simulations and so on. So we got good fundamental group. I work mostly here on low pressure processing, so I'm very much an engineer. So that I learn a lot from Miles, and I suppose Miles probably learns a lot from the data that we produce. And we've got a nascent atmospheric pressure processing activity. Not so much that it's something I get up and think about in the morning. In truth, albeit I have a number of students and PhD postdocs working in that area. Miles works on modeling in that area. I'm an engineer, so I build things. So we're building things like plasma jets, and the primary thing we're interested in at the moment is looking at plasma jets for sterilization in the clinical environment. And all that activity then enables us to have I would say a positive and finally a meaningful interaction with the various industries of semiconductor, biotechnology, and so on. My own group has, and I'm going to talk about my own group because I'm more comfortable naturally, and is, you know, we've got a little fab. We do a lot of metrology and characterization tools, so XRDs, SCMs, the usual things you'd find in a characterization lab, an energy lab. I use Miles's computation expertise, Bernard Kevel's computational expertise, and things like COMSOL and the usual things you'd have in a plasma simulation lab. We do the plasma medicine, which, that's too strong a word, it's really plasma sterilization and decontamination, but we've got ambition. And most relevant for the talk I'm going to give today is what I call the plasma engineering lab, which is a bit of a catch-all for our processing tools and so on. And within that lab, we have an Oxford Instruments tool, for example, with two chambers, an etch and depth chamber. Very, you see the mass spec up there. In fact, I don't have a proper diagnostic slide, but we do have a pretty decent set of diagnostics. We have a control experimental rig. We have a working ECR tool from Hitachi, which was a donation from Intel, which was a massive investment for us. And it's key to one of our major research projects, various diagnostics, lifts, and so on. And we've actually other plasma processing tools as well. So we got a wide variety of different kit that enable us to do a wide variety of different things. And again, as an engineer, I'm more motivated by solving problems. So I don't, I mean, I enjoy the physics, but it's not my primary motivation. My primary motivation is to solve the problem and get the physics to sort of help me to do that. So within the group at the moment, the three primary problem areas that we're working on is plasma measurement and control for highly reproducible surface engineering. That's primarily focused on semiconductor manufacturing. That's what I'm going to talk about today. I do a lot of work on surface functionalization for point of care diagnostics. It's a little bit like the last talk, but I'm talking about PECVD of things like Aptas and acrylic acids and other things like that for biomolecular mobilization. A lot of the problems we have in that particular project relates to reproducibility, which is another day's work. And again, as I said, a sterilization and environmental decontamination, which I'm not really going to talk about much today. Now, the context for picking the first topic is, as I said, Ireland sees itself as a manufacturing hub. So we were traditionally a manufacturing economy. Then we had the Celtic Tiger. We were no longer manufacturing. We were design and innovation and God knows what we were. Now we're back to being a manufacturing hub again, high volume manufacturing. Companies like Intel and so on are crucial to our economy. So it makes a lot of sense for us to invest in expertise to support that industry. And that is everything from, you know, interacting with them on research, but also, you know, providing people that are relevant to their business. So Intel, like when we produce PhDs, for example, in plasma physics to work in etch or dep or so on. Mike likes when we produce really smart people that he can hire that can innovate in the startups that you know, that are part of that overall structure, I suppose, of plasma technology within Ireland. So we see ourselves as anyway as a key manufacturing is a key plasma processing we can part of the key manufacturing technology, which we tell our funders, of course, that it's a, you know, it's a priority and it's in, and there's a need from Irish manufacturing organizations to be involved with us in industrially competitive research. And this is an old slide that Neil McGarrell has thrown out and I've thrown out over the years. And I mean, the message is simple, that as technology nodes have decreased, the precision required from our manufacturing processing tools has also increased. Our manufacturing process window has reduced. So my first mention of the word pulsed, of course, is the reason the word pulsed processing is becoming interesting is because, you know, we're looking at much smaller features, we're looking at much more delicate or thinner materials, so you're trying to have more control of things like your ion bombardment, you're looking at electron shading effects that might have impact on the shape of the feature you produce, and so on and so forth. That's, you know, one of the things that is needed to enable, you know, sub 22 nanometer technology nodes, okay, certainly. But also, beyond the sexy things like pulsing, there's, you know, you go into any fab and you ask the fab manager what's your problem, he's going to talk to you about particles, he's going to talk to you about yield, and he's going to talk to you about process variation. So process variation is actually where it's really at for most of the fabs. So you got a tool that's not matched to another tool, or a chamber that's not matched to another chamber, or lot one is not the same as lot 25. Now you've got a problem that costs you money. Okay, so, and this, that problem becomes more pronounced the tighter your tolerances. So you can live with less variation. Therefore, your metrology costs go up, your diagnostics costs go up, and the need for sensors and more control in your manufacturing processes, such as plasma, becomes more pronounced. So things like better process reproducibility, our ability to control the CD with more, both across the wafer as well as just individual CDs. And my thesis for this talk, at least, is one of the things you need to control is the radical things, the radical species within the plasma. So very, very simple plasma where you may have oxygen and fluorine, for example, you need to control those. And primarily the thing you need to control is the ratio between those species. Now, we can argue all day about other things, such as ion bombardment and other radicals and deposition versus not deposition. But at the end of the day, in any process, there are things that are the primary driver. So we're not going to try and solve every problem, but we're going to pick what we think are probably the primary problems to solve. And the problem I'm trying to solve is to control the radical, primary radical densities that are having an impact on the things that are most important to me. Now, again, second use of the word pulse, okay? Pulsed plasmas, you know, I mean, the other things that are that would bother me as a manufacturing manager would be, you know, plasma-induced damage, for example, of my low-k dielectrics or my gates, for example. My anisotropy, as I scale down. My selectivity, my etch rate, and so on. All those things are very important, not always regulated by the oxygen radicals, of course, or determined by the degree of radicals in your plasma. But for example, one of the speakers earlier on talked about, I think it was Timo, talked about, well, you know, with this pulsed plasma, you have another knob you can turn. It gives you more control. Well, it gives you more complexity. Whether it gives you more control is a longer discussion, okay? But certainly the potential advantages, for example, to reduce the thermal loading of the wafer could help you. To reduce the amount of UV exposed to your low-k could help you, for example, okay? Reduce the degree of electron shading could help your anisotropy and so on, okay? So there's a lot of potential advantages of using pulse plasmas, and it's another thing, certainly it's another knob that would need to be controlled. But I would argue that even today, in 99.99% of the fabs, we don't have a huge degree of control, even of the current knobs that we have. So when we introduce another one, we're going to have another degree of problems. I'm not going to talk about PECVD. I just want to make the point, based on what I saw from earlier talks, that when, you know, I'm going to talk about etch primarily, but the problems that I talk about etch are, you know, they're kind of sort of replicated in PECVD, albeit slightly differently. I can't remember who said it earlier on about what with the pulse process. One potential disadvantage is the lack of reactivity of my process, which is absolutely correct. But in actual fact, with another hat on, like I said, that's actually a really good thing, because when I'm trying to produce my biosensors, I actually want to have really, really controlled reactivity in my process, because I'm trying to engineer very specific chemistry onto my surface. So that can also be an advantage of a disadvantage. So, you know, your ability to control your electron energy's diffusion function, which somehow gives you some control of the degree of dissociation in your process, is a potential advantage, again, which pulse plasmas might be able to give you, in addition to controlling things like charging at the surface and other things like that, which might be important for a process like this. In any case, not going to talk too much about PECVD. I suppose our flagship project in the university currently is Precision, which has Intel, Stratum, that should be Lam now, various other impedance, of course, and Applied have a limited involvement in Truth. But in any case, it's a pretty substantial project. We're in year three or so, and it's understanding the plasma, that's the fundamentals that Miles Turner leads. Developing the processes, that's the engineering stuff that I would lead, and then characterizing the process outcome. So we've got characterization and metrology experts like Paddy McNally, who's one of our colleagues. So that is to understand it, improve it, and then demonstrate that we've improved it. Now the primary, you know, well, this workshop is about diagnostics, of course, and pulse plasma diagnostics, so third time to mention it, okay? But in actual fact, I mean, when you go into any fab, pretty much on the planet, the diagnostic that's available to you needs to cost about $5,000-$6,000, okay? It needs to be about that size, it needs to stick on the chamber, not interfere with the process, or it's probably not going to be in the fab, okay? You may have one in the development fab, okay? So the diagnostic that's mostly used is optical emission spectroscopy. It's on production tools. It's there for endpoint detection. It's there a little bit for advanced process control, possibly. It can be used for leak detection and other things like that. It's mostly, in fact, really used for endpoint detection. But, you know, the advent of virtual metrology, which in some circles now is a bit of a dirty word, I know, but virtual metrology has, you know, the idea of the concept behind virtual metrology is where you take measurements that are available to you, such as OES data. So what I've got here, I've got this is my wavelength. This shouldn't say time. This is a wafer number. So this is you know, several months data from wafer fab, which takes OES data and correlates that OES data with something such as deposition rate in this case, or actually etch rate. That says doesn't matter. A parameter, okay? And you can use that information to build a statistical model. So you can, there's various techniques, principal components and so on, and you need some way of training it and, you know, blah, blah, blah. You end up in a model that you can use to predict the parameter that you cannot directly measure, such as your etch rate or your dep rate or whatever, okay? That's kind of sort of the state of the art of using diagnostics in a fab for something useful. And that tells you something about, you know, in this case, your my depth rate. And, you know, with a lot of work, you can get, I mean, you can't actually see that, so it's stupid to show it, but you can actually get a really, really high level of confidence in a very, very controlled fab where you've got the same process running every day, okay? And it's useful for, as I described, telling you what your depth rate is, but also for looking for faults, for example. So you might be able to tell, look at chamber clean, there's a problem in chamber clean, there's a problem with an MFC and so on. And that stuff, in fact, that Mike would have worked on years ago in, we called it, what did we call it? Fault detection and classification and so on. Okay, but that's, even though that was talked about generations back, it's still not really, really, in truth, in most fabs, up to scratch. And why do we have variation? So there's numbers of reasons why we have variation, okay? And I'm going to just touch on one or two, okay? And in fact, they've been talked by the previous speakers and other speakers in terms of the effects of surfaces in contact with the plasma. So this is something you'll see in one of the posters outside tomorrow. If I just look at a very simple plasma with oxygen, and I change the surface, in this case, I change what was on my chuck on the Oxford Instruments tool, I can have a pretty serious impact on my oxygen radical density. Okay, so we're gonna have an order of magnitude change on my oxygen radical density or my electron density as I have here. It doesn't matter whether, I mean, this is real, but it doesn't really matter what it is. The point is that the plasma facing surfaces have a huge impact on the composition of the plasma. And that's a dynamic thing. That changes dependent on, have I got photoresist coming off? Well, in fact, I have data here. So if I have my process, a stable process, so if I don't do anything with my nice chamber, I don't process anything, it'll be nice and stable, okay? So no surprise there. But once I start to do something like here, this is we process some photoresist wafers just to see what the sort of variation you would expect, and no surprise, you have a substantial variation. And Samir can talk to you about details of that if anyone's interested in that. Tomorrow at the poster session. But, you know, from other work, well, I didn't do, but would come from a European project we were involved in, we know that a slight variation in, for example, my oxygen radical density is going to have a substantial variation in my device structures. So, being an engineer, problem, like to solve the problem. What are we going to try and do? Well, we could try and re-engineer every plasma system on the planet or come up with magic surfaces that have the same recombination coefficients. That's not going to happen. So our approach is closed-loop process control. And as I said earlier, I talked a little bit about virtual metrology and advanced process control. Well, we're a little bit more ambitious than that. Advanced process control, for example, theoretically at least, should learn from the previous wafer and adjust the process for the next wafer or the next lot or whatever. Okay? What we're trying to do is achieve within wafer control. So as the process is proceeding and you see a change in your oxygen radical density, your fluorine radical density, we want to be able to deal with the actuators and regulate the production of those radicals in the plasma with the hope that we're going to regulate the process outcome. So most processing tools today are open loop. Well, all processing tools today that you can buy are open loop control. So you have your process, you have your various actuators for power and pressure and gas flows and so on, and you have your ideal and you have your real process outcome. I beg your pardon, my slides aren't wrong. So, and the reasons you have a deviation from the ideal performance is because you've got disturbances. You've got, when you put a wafer into your process, it's going to shift the impedance, it's going to have scratches on the back, you're going to have some helium leaking in, you're going to have some photoresist going on your shower head and so on. So you're going to be just loading and disturbing the plasma and the processing system itself. So what we would like to achieve to achieve this within wafer control is to put some sort of a controller in the system. So multi-in but multi-output controller that's going to regulate these things that I mentioned earlier. For example, the radicals. Doesn't need to just be the radicals, of course. For that, I'm going to need sensors, and those sensors are going to need to provide me of an estimation of the things I want to control in order to provide some feedback into my controller. Problem with a 5K sensor that's got to fit in my hand and has to look through a window that gets dirty is I can only estimate those things. Okay, so in actual fact, the things that are really important to control my process outcome are kind of uncertain. Well, in fact, can be very uncertain. So it's not just, well, I don't believe you can just do that. You can use, and I'm going to talk a little bit about actinometry later on to get a reasonably good estimate of what my oxygen radical density is. But you know what? Something the last speaker mentioned about, if I don't know what my electron energy distribution function is, for example, there's orders of magnitude uncertainty in my estimation of the oxygen radical density. So I can't really I can control, but I don't really know what I'm controlling. That might be okay if there's one processing tool on the planet, but if I've got to replicate it from fab to fab and I got to deal about chamber matching and things like that, now it becomes a problem. So absolute numbers do actually matter when you're trying to achieve things like chamber matching and so on. So I need some other scheme. So I'll talk about this in a little bit more detail, but I need some way of improving that estimation. And I'll talk, we use PIC simulations. I need some way of telling me I'm not insane when I do that. I need to calibrate it, and I need that to, in addition to my sensor data, I need some other sanity data, if you like, to enhance my estimation so that I'm actually controlling something sensible. So we went and built, in the first instance, so we have an old Oxford instrument, an ancient Oxford instrument too, which is really not that anymore because Yang and Bernard and other people have gone and stripped it out. And we got our own LabVIEW-based controller thing in the box. We have simple process, argon, oxygen, SF6, RF power, and things we want to control are oxygen, fluorine, and my electron density. So this was our first attempt last year, or the year before, maybe last 18 months or so, to build an in-situ, sensor-based, multivariable, real-time feedback control system. Okay, and we'd say we're the first people to do this. Maybe we're there or thereabouts in any case. Okay, and the objectives ultimately is to reduce process sensitivity to these disturbances. So I cannot stop polymer buildup on my wall. Okay, I can't do that. I don't believe, well, I can't do that. Maybe somebody else can do that. So we got to remove the sensitivity to those types of things, and hence the control system. And we use OES, and we use a hairpin probe, which is an interesting diagnostic, so we're not going to have time to talk today. Now, unfortunately, the hairpin probe, it is somewhat invasive. It doesn't shift your process, but I'm not certain really that it's something that's practical from a manufacturing perspective. But in any case, that's what we use because we feel we need some measure of electron density. And the diagnostics are interesting. The physics is very interesting, and the control is also interesting. But in truth, you can do an awful lot with basic control engineering. So you can get a step response, and you can use standard control engineering techniques to work out your time delay and your gain, and you can work out your transfer function. So you can build the dynamic responses system, and you can get the parameters you need to inform your PI controller. And just on that orange system that I showed you a few minutes back, when we started to implement, this was for electron density control. So we started off with single input, single output electron density control. And you can see that as we from open loop to closed loop, if I have a if I turn on my RF power supply, and I say go to 80 watts or whatever, you see if you look at the electron density, 4.5 minutes later, it's still deciding to get to some sort of steady state. Okay, now you can argue it's first wafer effect and so on. It isn't far from optimized chamber, in fact, and I'm sure it's better in actual manufacturing tools, but I guarantee it's there or thereabouts. So, but once you actually try and control the electron density, as opposed to controlling telling the RF power supply to go to a certain number, you can improve that performance significantly. Now, in fact, we're saying here 25%, 25 seconds as opposed to 4.5 minutes. And also you can engineer your system to, follow your set point. So now I'm telling it to go to X, Y, and Z electron density. But also, you know, here's a pressure disturbance. So I can also engineer my system so that it starts to reject disturbances. Okay, so now I changed my pressure, but my electron density didn't change. And same methodology can be applied to other things such as oxygen, my fluorine containing molecules. So I have my inputs, I have my outputs, and no feedback control. If I vary, I can't remember, I can't see it here myself, but my electron density, my oxygen, and my fluorine. Okay, I'll see a response on my OES that's appropriate for those particular species. Okay, so if I vary, let's say, electron density and I see it here, but I also see that I'm having a disturbance, I'm disturbing my other radicals. So I'm controlling one thing, but I'm having an impact on other things, which is not ideal, of course. Hence, I can build a multi-input, multi-output system. Again, I can get the dynamics of the system using the step response, and I can build my controller. We don't need to go into this because we don't have time. Again, I'm not a control engineer. I could bullshit about it. I can give you the broad, but the real engineer is over there. But you can build your controller. You can build your PID controller. And you can demonstrate closed-loop control now of electron density, fluorine, and oxygen for a pretty basic plasma, admittedly. But again, so, you know, I have some degree of disturbance rejection. So, for example, here's my electron density. I see some fluorine and oxygen responses, but in fact, you know, there is a significant degree of interactions. You see this interaction here, that shouldn't be there. I see some interaction there for this response and vice versa. So standard engineering technique to deal with that is to introduce some sort of feedback or decoupling. So you can build additional functionality into your control system. You can build what's called decouplers. Again, they're built as a standard control methodology for doing that. And when you introduce decoupling, you can minimize the loop interaction. So what you're doing is you're independently controlling my fluorine, my oxygen, and my electron density in this case here. Okay, so I think I've shown that a few minutes ago, sort of. But now I have electron density, fluorine, and oxygen. And with open loop, you know, what's that? 200 seconds or so, it's still kind of sort of deciding what it's going to do. But with closed loop control, it does what I tell it to do within a much better time frame. Okay. And you can engineer this. I'm not going to bore you with this, but you can engineer this to disturb things like, you know, helium or things that would be kind of typical things that would be introduced to the wafer into a process into that shouldn't cause a yield problem, but can disturb your process. So, you know, helium. The backside helium can be into your process from a scrape in the back of a wafer, for example. Okay, so we've got our head around how to do control for a basic plasma using a standard set of diagnostics on an experimental tool that a PhD student primarily built, which is fantastic. Next big challenge for us is to do this on a real production tool. So we're working on a Hitachi ECR tool. It's got its microwave and its RF and all these other things that you need to control. The system's got its own control system. And what we've done is we've built a parallel control system that when we want to run closed loop control, we take the necessary controls, if you like, away from the system controller to our own PC control, and we control these actuators. And we have, I mean, this diagram is not completely accurate because we also obviously have our diagnostics feeding back into our control system. Sounds like a trivial, well, it doesn't sound like a trivial thing. I can do it in one slide. Huge amount of work in order to try and achieve this. And it's work in progress. You know, but I would say this slide here, I think, just shows, you know, for example, that which is a production tool, which has a fully trained operator working on the tool, it drifts. You know, it's you know, you can see here, these are some OES peaks from argon, oxygen, and fluorine again, and it drifts over time. I mean, that's 8,000 seconds. I don't know how many minutes that is, but it's a lot more than it should be, okay, in open loop control. And I'm not actually presenting this data as such, other than I want to say that we are now achieving, Yang, Bernard, and Caesar and other folks are achieving control on that system. And you see the similar type of, you know, interactions and so on. It's only early stage work all the time, but we're very hopeful. And once we have demonstrated control, at least based on our plasma diagnostics, the next step over the next couple of months is to demonstrate control on product. So we'll be etching some process and trying to demonstrate the improvements that control will give you over no control. So I must be nearly finished. I'm talking about processing chambers, processing wafers, using sensors to have a controller to actuate the actuators of the processing system so you can achieve this regulation. Sorry, I know what I was going to say next was, that's all fine. I started off saying that's great, Stephen, so you're controlling a thing, but is that thing important? And if you go to a different chamber, are you just controlling a thing that's different from the other chamber? So it doesn't really achieve necessarily what I wanted to achieve for high-volume manufacturing. So I need some way of estimating my radicals. And, you know, if it's an OES, and I typically have argon, oxygen, and other things in my plasma, actinometry is a reasonably good technique to use. Because without going into the details, I won't. I mean, you know, you look at your OES. This is a simple OES for argon and oxygen. You can estimate your, in this case, my oxygen radical density, you know, with a knowledge of my argon and an estimation of my molecular oxygen concentration. I look at the intensity of the light produced from the spectrometer. I've got some correction factors due to the hardware and other things. Don't worry about that for now. Okay. As an engineer, you say, okay, there's an equation and I can work it out, but actually, what don't I actually know? No, I actually don't know that really. That's another discussion. I have an estimate for that. This depends how well my spectrometers are calibrated relative to each other, but that's another discussion as well. But what I really don't know is my rate constants, because my rate constants are determined, which presumably you can't see here, are determined by my electrons, my electron temperatures, okay? And in fact, they're a strong function of my electron temperature. So here for oxygen, my 777844 nanometer oxygen, I can see, well, first of all, they respond differently to a change in my electron temperature. And if I look at my equation here, I mean, look at these ratios here, particularly this ratio here, because this is my primary source of error. If I don't know what this is, I don't know what that is. And particularly if this ratio here is uncertain, that's uncertain. So just ballpark order of magnitude. If I look at 777, I assume a Maxwellian distribution, I assume a Dravestian distribution. I have, you know, I don't know, not an order of magnitude, but a substantial uncertainty in my measurement. So typical standard practice would be to choose an EEDF. My point is, I choose the wrong EEDF. And my measurement can be order out by an order of magnitude. Similarly, with the I can't actually read that there. Okay, I can't read my own slide, so I can't remember what I'm going to say there. In any case, you get the point. So if I look at my overall measurement uncertainty for two standard peaks that I might use for oxygen, and people say, "Oh God, no, don't use 777. Use 844. It's much more accurate from an actinometer perspective." That's all fine, but try doing that in a fab with a window that's half coated with a polymer and you're trying to find a really small peak. Okay, so, you know, if it's available and it gives you information, I think it should be used. But in any case, dependent on, whether I use dissociative excitation or otherwise, whether I use a Maxwellian or Dravestian distribution, you know, my estimation of radical densities is insanely incorrect if I don't have an accurate estimation of my EEDF. Okay. Now, trying to get an accurate estimation of an EEDF in a production tool in a fab is also a challenging thing, albeit tools tend to be manufactured with a high degree of tolerance. So, and your processes don't seem to change very much. So, I mean, it can be done once and you have a pretty good estimation of what it would be estimation will be from chamber to chamber. And now the problem is compounded, I think, and I did this slide, well, Bernard did this very simple simulation for me just for this talk, okay? I don't know what my EEDF is for a continuous wave plasma in a production fab with any great certainty. And that's compounded now when I start to pulse my plasma, right? Because as you can see, this is a, you know, this was just a simulation just to illustrate the point, but you see my electron density is changing, my temperature is changing, and my radical densities and my ion densities are also changing. It's only a cartoon, I realize, but it's just to make the point. So one way we've proposed to get around this problem, so we can control the peaks, but we don't really know what the peaks means with any great certainty. Okay? So that's the second problem. And one proposed method, which from my applied materials background I call my best known method, okay, is to use a peak simulation. So I assume for my processing tool I have my OAS measurements. I assume I have some measure of electron density, and well, I'm assuming I have some way of validating everything I say, okay, for here. Okay. I can use particle and SEM simulations to simulate for a given geometry, a given chemistry, a known set of conditions. I can produce an EEDF that'll tell, and I can produce an estimate of my electron density. Okay, now in electronegative plasmas, which is what we tend to use, it's very hard to get Langmuir probes in there, very hard to interpret the results. But I can get a reasonably good estimate of my electron density. So our theorem, if you like, is that if I get a good estimate of my electron density based on my simulation, then I can assume that my electron density distribution function is correct. You could argue with me on that, but it's a reasonable approximation, I think. So calculate my EEDF, validate my EEDF, then calculate my rate constants, use those rate constants in my actinometry model, compare that with my actual measurements from my processing tool, and I have now some confidence in my absolute atomic oxygen density. That's the theory, okay? And we've reasonably good confidence that the peak simulations that we do, again, this is on one of the students' posters outside, that the EEDS we produce from the peak simulations, and this is actual experimental data from a Langmuir probe, we've reasonably good confidence that the peak simulation we produce are accurate. You get more detail outside. So this work is not complete, but now you're comparing to way back when I was looking at the uncertainty in my measurement. Now I'm within the ballpark. So for my actinometry, as I function, this is a function of RF power. This is my atomic oxygen radical density estimation or measurement. So there's my estimation based on actinometry, and dependent on whether I choose a 777 or 844 line, and this is my my absolute measurement based on my LIF. And this work is not published because it's not ready, but you can see that we're getting into the right ballpark. And what we'd like to do is link the controller to a surface profile simulator, so that, for example, as a tool, a diagnostic tool, so that the fluxes we produce from our measurements would feed into something like this, which would tell you, well, how is my sidewall varying and so on as my process is fluctuating. But I'm saying we're going to control. I can't assume we can control it perfectly. So in conclusion, there's a lot of work for us to do in achieving this control, naturally. I would say that in preparing for this workshop, I had a lot more attention to pulse plasmas. And I have to say, there's a lot of hugely interesting possibilities for pulse plasmas in manufacturing. So I'll stop talking now because you're all yawning and I look tired. I'll say thank you. And thanks, of course, to the team who did all this work. Okay, thanks.
Thank you, Stephen, for an almost perfectly timed talk. Questions?
Well, doing the real-time monitoring, the real-time feedback, is it possible to couple the work that you're doing with sophisticated simulations to see what the cost of, when you're controlling three parameters, then you force them to match what you want them to be? Where the cost is, if you return identity, is that the EDF changing? Is it something else changing, which you're not monitoring, in order to get that 25 second
You mean feature scale simulation or plasma simulation?
Well, probably a couple of simulations, yeah. Yes, but even just for the plasma simulation.
Yeah, so we do, I mean, I didn't present it today. So Bernard will do, we have global models and we would run the control algorithm, if you like, on the global models to give us so we can get a better understanding of what the impact of changing one parameter has on another. Absolutely, yeah. Running in parallel is absolutely something we could consider doing, yeah. Yeah. I mean, but where we are at the moment, we are further developing global models that are, you know, will give us a better picture of what's going on, yeah. Yeah. But still.
Any more questions?
I think it was perfectly clear.
Well, if there's no more questions from the audience, I have one. So how far do you think is this away from actually being used? Could you give an estimate of the time scale for that?
Well, we hope to have, the next step for us is to demonstrate fluorine, oxygen, and electrons on the Hitachi tool. And we'd like to have something we could publish by Christmas, okay? If you're asking me seriously when you'd see this in a fab, you're several years away, I think. I mean, I've masked over a lot of other problems that we would encounter in a real production tool, okay. You know. But you know, I know the OEMs are and have been looking at this for quite a while. Right. Yeah, yeah. Okay. But I think 2 to 5 years, maybe. Yeah. Who knows?
Being optimistic.
Being optimistic, but knowing OEMs as well. Yeah,
yeah, yeah.
Yeah, so.
Okay.
if you're trying to control three parameters or three or four, what's the complexity if you need to add another one to it? If you've got to do five rather than four, is that a lot of extra work in between?
I think the problem, well, there's two sets of problems. The problem is getting the right measurement, okay, and all that comes with that. So it depends a little bit on what you want to measure, yeah. And then from a control perspective, now again, Bernard maybe could answer this better than I could afterwards, but you know, this idea of all these interactions between the loops, there's a huge amount of engineering. So it's a multiple of itself every time you try and do it. So you have to have, I don't know if I have a good diagram here, you know, these decouplers, every time you introduce a new parameter, you got to decouple that from every other parameter. So it's not a trivial thing, yeah.
So I guess the question was that linear, is it just two more parameters that on top of two, is it twice as much?
Yeah. it will depend on the degree of decoupling or coupling that's required, which we don't actually know yet. Yeah.
In the Zoom call, I mean, what we can do is in a fashion is figure out what is the top contributions to variability and control those. So if it is, for example, if it's a dimension you're trying to control and it's the variability of oxygen that drives your critical dimensions, then that becomes the first thing. And you can learn that from statistics and machine learning in a factory that would drive
it. Yeah, this sort of thing here.
Yeah.
So when you develop your principal components, for example, you'll know what the primary chemistry, if you like, that's leading to, for example, the sort of variation that we see here. Yeah.
If you've got something which usually isn't a problem, but it's very stable,
yeah.
If you force three other things to change,
absolutely, yeah.
Make it worse.
Yeah. But that's also the power of the simulations that you mentioned earlier on, yeah. Yeah. Okay.
Okay. Right. More questions? Okay, then I guess Dave is probably going to say something about the dinner.
Yeah.
Okay, thank you again.